Let's first logically think about what people are doing. I think Dr. Grossman and I would agree that sometimes you can concentrate essential oils and maybe with some rare disease conditions, essential fatty acids, omegas, we have ways to measure these things. And with a really concentrated source of particular types of essential oils, there's been proof of people reversing certain disease conditions, certain eczema, certain skin conditions. Dr. Press did an experiment. This is a long time ago. And he put people on a glucose IV, which meant they had zero fat intake, zero protein intake for over a month. And at the end of the month, people started developing a little eczema, a little skin condition. Instead of giving them any fat to take into their diet, they left them on the glucose IV, and all they did was rub a little bit of oil on the skin, not even where the lesions were developing, a little bit of oil. They calculated that the absorption of fat was less than 0.01% fat in the diet, which the average American takes in 50% fat, 40, 50% fat in their diet. And you tell me, oh, we're not getting enough fat, so now you're drinking oils? This is insane, people. 0.01% relieved the essential fatty acid deficiency, and it was all they needed. All they needed in human nutrition. So what I'm saying is giving you the extreme so you understand that if you eat a handful of walnuts, and preferably you soak them so the nuts and seeds come alive. This morning I had flaxseed, chia seed, and hemp seed soaked in water, left it overnight, and put a little banana in there, and I put a drop of stevia, and I ate that. That's my breakfast in the morning. And then I transitioned to green drinks and beet drinks and Slim Blend protein. So I'm having so much essential fatty acids and nutrients, but not in the extracted oil form. Do you know when you soak chia seeds, have you ever noticed in flax seeds, they become like a mushy gel? That mushy gel has the ability to soak up cholesterol and draw it right out of your system. Essential fatty acids are best from your whole natural foods. Why are you extracting them out into oils unless you're trying to relieve some kind of disease condition?
And what we can say about these essential fatty acids and other fats, the balance is critical. So for most Americans, they're totally out of balance. They're eating fatty acids that are not healthy, that are not the EPAs and DHAs and the fats that the brain needs for normal functioning, that the nerves need. They're fats that are imbalancing, that create inflammation, that come out of animal fats and milk fats, and these are not good for you. So not only are they eating too much of it, but they're eating the wrong balance of it, and that just overthrows the whole balance in the system. So the balance is critical. So if you're eating, as you described, some nuts or some seeds, you're getting a whole different balance of fatty acids that help inflammation in the body, to help the brain, to help the body to function more normally. So that's a critical thing. The other thing that I might add is that when you're talking about the fruits, we want to be clear that we're not talking about fruit juice.
Because particularly industrial fructose is man-made, which has no polyphenols. But one study was done on fruit juice that showed there were still polyphenols. Yes. The blood sugar stabilized better, but not as good as eating the whole
fruit.
So
if you can eat a lot of apple juice, it doesn't have a lot of the and if you eat a lot of the cranberry juice, they put in all the sugar in there.
Right.
And so that's a whole different
product. Eat the cranberry, eat the apple.
Right.
And if you puree the apple, it's become a little bit processed. I prefer to eat my whole fruit and juice my greens and use that as a base in my Vitamix and add sweet potato and other things to blend to get all the fiber as well.
So we can talk about the vegetables. So when you juice the greens, so just to clarify things for our audience, if you eat spinach and kale and chard, you chew it up, it's a lot of good fiber, but you're not getting a lot of the nutrients from the greens because the body cannot digest plant fiber the way cows do. We can't eat grass and we can't eat that and get the value. Whereas if you put it in a blender and it goes super fast, and there's many different types of blenders, it breaks down the cell wall and you actually get the nutrients. You also get the nutrients if you lightly cook the vegetable. You get a little bit of it, a little less of it, but you still get a good amount. But if you do the juicing of the vegetables, you're getting the inner contents without cooking it. And that gives you a lot of the minerals that otherwise you may not get. It gives you a lot of antioxidants, which you otherwise won't be getting. So that is a very healthy thing to do. But putting in the fruit juice in there, when you put the whole fruit in there, you're not adding anything, because you can eat an apple and get all the nutrients. You can eat a mango or a berry and get all the nutrients. Yes, you can put it in the blender. What I have people do is make sure that you blend super fast the greens. But when you're putting in the other things, don't go super fast with it. You don't have to super fast your berries and your other things. You just want to mix it in so that it tastes good, but you don't have to break down the cell wall.
Right. So I'd like people to know that in this Immortality series, this monthly series, that they're going to learn about the ultimate in fitness levels. What is the best kind of training to prolong life or to become a super athlete, as I'm about to prove again here in 6 weeks, competing against some of the world's strongest strength endurance athletes, where they're willing to bet $1 million against me. I'd like to see who's taking that bet. I know who to bet on in this one. And you wait and see how I perform against these super athletes. They'll be on steroids, they'll be using chemicals, they'll be using drugs. I know the guy I'm going against. Well, he just came out of prison. If that tells you a little bit about, you know, his nature. I don't think he's opposed to cheating on the rules, but I don't care what chemical he uses. He's going against Nick Delgado, natural, and I'm going to beat him in his game. And I'm choosing the weight. He's got to keep up with me. We'll see how he does. He just did 2,500 push-ups recently in 2.5 hours, and he won a $600,000 bet for his gamblers. We'll see. We'll see what he does against me. We'll have some fun with that one. Fitness level, hormones, better sleep. Does sleep improve hormones, doctor?
Does
quality sleep, does that improve your hormone production?
Sleep is critical for hormone production. If you don't sleep good, your hormones are really all off.
So if I get to bed by 9 o'clock and I get my full 8 hours sleep, I use my laser focused glasses. If I wake up in the middle of the night, I actually time myself to see how much quality sleep I get. Most men I talk to notice if they turn the clock up sooner, instead of pushing through to get their deadlines or work done and then, you know, frazzled at 12 midnight, 1 o'clock, they go to sleep every night drinking coffee to stay awake, and then they wake up, you know, very difficult in the morning. Who's going to produce the best level of hormone levels? Testosterone, DHEA, growth hormone, all the rejuvenative hormones. That person that gets to bed early and goes to bed at close to sunset and sunrise is up early for their 8 hours, or the guy who gets still 8 hours, but it's past one in the morning, and he sleeps till, you know, maybe still wakes up at 7 or 8 because he's kind of programmed to wake up, but he pushes to get his 8 hours or not. Who's going to have the better hormonal level?
Healthy sleep in the right hours is critical. The human body is designed to go to sleep when it gets dark out and wake up when it gets light out. And that's what the human body is designed to do that. And if you don't cooperate with that, you don't live as long. There's a lot of studies, and we see it all the time.
30% longer if you get quality sleep.
There's many studies.
There's hardly any factor that causes longevity than one single factor is sleep.
There's been so many studies on nurses and physicians who have these funny hours, and they just die early. It's really sad.
All my chronic fatigue patients who tell me I'm so stressed out, I can't keep up with my demands, I ask them, what time do you go to bed? Oh, they always say this, 12 midnight, 1 o'clock, 2 in the morning. I said, why? They said, well, I got to get these things done. I got to keep up with my demand. I said, well, you get colds and flus, you're chronically sick. So then you lose time there when you're sick. You're not at your peak performance. And I say, well, so you go to sleep, you wake up, you know, later in the day. I got guys who are up late all night and then they sleep all day, you know, and yet they're fatigued. They don't understand why they're fatigued. I said, do me a favor, turn your clock back, just go to bed, regardless if your job isn't done, go to bed 9 o'clock. I know that's asking a lot, maybe shoot for 10, just turn it back 2-3 hours earlier, you know, 9 or 10 o'clock. And then just see how, when you wake up in the morning without an alarm, without coffee. I never use an alarm or coffee to wake myself up, because if you don't wake up on your own accord, you're sleep deprived. You do that one simple thing and it will skyrocket your energy levels. You're going to have to put, oh gosh, I didn't finish my deadline. So you go to bed at 9 o'clock, you wake up 8 hours later. What's 9 o'clock to 8 hours later? What time is that in the morning? It's 5 in the morning. Now you've got about 3 quality hours, 5, 6, seven, eight, you got about three, nine, you got about 3-4 hours of quality time to do and finish whatever that project was that you thought you couldn't finish. And you know who I'm talking to in this audience, probably all of you. You got that time and you get it done. You get to work by nine or whatever your issue is, or whenever fortunately, when you know you work for your own, you show up when you want to show up, but you still got to show up to work and you got to show up sharp.
So a couple of things I would add in this area of sleep. One, the one thing I cannot treat, I have to refer out, is sleep apnea people. If you have a snoring problem and if you're not getting a deep sleep, we can give you all the nutrients and so forth. It's a mechanical issue. You got to get that taken care of. So that's one area that people have to handle that. Two, when women get older and they go into menopause, their hormones are off and they just can't sleep. And you need to be replacing the hormones. Natural human progesterone is real critical for women to have normal sleep. And so I do that all the time. And so sleep is critical. If you're going to live long and healthy, you've got to sleep good, as Dr. Nick describes. But for women going into menopause, it's not a psychological issue. It's a hormonal issue. You've got to have the right hormones. The other thing that we can find is that as people get older, men and women, you lose growth hormone. And without growth hormone, you don't rejuvenate the brain. You don't sleep deeply. You don't go into REM sleep. You don't feel good when you wake up in the morning. And that's for people generally 50 and older. It gets worse and worse. You may have to do things to replenish growth hormone. The other thing that goes down as we get older is melatonin. As people get older, you lose melatonin. Your body doesn't make melatonin, which is needed to have a normal sleep cycle, to get you to sleep, to feel like you're going to be sleeping. And it's very important. The other thing that happens, as Dr. Nick was describing, is cortisol. When you wake up in the morning and you don't feel energetic and refreshed and you need that coffee to get going, that's a sign that your adrenal glands are not functioning properly. You need to regulate that. You need to balance that out. There's many ways that we balance that out. Could be nutritional things, could be stress reduction, could be meditation, it could be changing various things in your lifestyle. But you've got to feel, when you wake up in the morning, energy. If you're not feeling awakened, wow, it's a new day, I can't wait to go, there's a problem here. And you have to play detective, because there's not just one thing that makes that happen. So that's what Nick and I will do, is play detective and figure out what is the issue here.
I think people underestimate the importance of the light, dark cycles that influence your circadian rhythm and your hormones. For example, we're under the bright lights. You'd think, oh, I'm getting light. You're barely getting 50,000 lux of energy. You step outdoors in the sun, you're getting 500,000 lux of energy. There's no way you're ever going to match the amount of important daylight. We're like plants too. We need light to thrive, and we need light. We got to go outdoors, put a bikini on, put a swimsuit on, get your body exposed, go in your backyard naked. Don't get in trouble or anything, but get your body, get some sun. They did a study where they put sunlight on men's scrotum. Their testosterone went up 69%, LH, luteinizing hormone, a dramatic increase. I'm not saying you go run around, with your balls hanging out, but there's Ebok. He's going to show it now. It's all good. But the point is that sun on the body, we were designed to run naked outdoors, and now we've covered ourselves up because we have this society, we're all worried about Puritans and something's horrible going to happen if we see a naked body. Good grief. So now we've compromised our health. You go to the islands and people run around naked, they barely wear any clothes. And why are they so healthy? You go on a vacation for a week or two and you come back suntan, you feel revitalized, right? But at night, you go and you have night lights and you think it's a joke. I was with a doctor friend, and we saw this night light in the room, and I said, go kill the son of a bitch. Oh, excuse me. I said, cover that light up quick, because that little bit of night light was enough to interfere with the melatonin, to decrease your melatonin by 50% within minutes of exposure to your phone plugged in and that little light. You make it extremely dark at night like those nice luxury hotels where it's so dark, you're like, oh, wow, there's something about that. The human body wasn't exposed to a bunch of bright lights at night, Las Vegas lights, outdoor lights. All that light is horrible at night. Just get airplane mask, you know, just wear the little mask. I think we have one where we do the laser focus glasses. Cut out that light to your eyes at night, so long as you want to get back to sleep. And then turn the light up during the day. Get outdoors at least an hour or two. Go naked if you can.
And what I would add is that when now we have lots of studies on vitamin D levels, the average Californian is deficient in vitamin D. You'd think that it's not like we're living in Washington where it's cloudy all the time, or Seattle, but we're deficient in vitamin D because we're wearing so many clothes and we're not going outside. Deficiency in vitamin D is a huge problem for so many issues, for your bone strength, for your mood, for cancer, for heart disease, for arthritis, for diabetes, for weight loss. It's like the list goes on and on. You've got to have enough vitamin D. So often we give vitamin D. I will give vitamin D. I want your levels to be 55.
Vitamin D3, right?
Vitamin D3. 55 to 80 would be the range that we like it to be in. But the question still exists, does it do everything for the brain that natural sunlight does? Probably not, but it's a lot better than being deficient. But still, if you feel good and you want to feel good, you want to be outside and be doing things outside. And we haven't talked about just general exercise at all. Is that on our list here?
Definitely. I work out outdoors. I don't even go in the gym. Once in a while, you'll see me in a gym. I take my dumbbells outdoors in the daylight. I have my swim trunks on because I got to cover up. People will freak out if I'm naked. And I go out to the beach and I lift nonstop while I'm breathing the ocean air, the breeze, and I'm lifting. And you'll see me. I'll be going out to Inspiration Point. You'll see me at Newport Beach right there next to the pier, or I go to Huntington Beach. And when I'm training to break a world record or compete in this $1 million bet, you'll see me out there every day training, not in a gym. Part of it is because I want the daylight to stimulate my body and releasing all the natural hormones, cortisol, testosterone, DHA, all these hormones released when you're in outdoor daylight. And then people say, oh, but the sun, it's going to cause skin cancer. Do you realize that when the sun hits the skin, there's what's called dehydrocholesterol, and it converts into the vitamin D and all the nutrients our body needs. But if we take oils, vegetable oils, polyunsaturated fats and corn oils and olive oils, it depletes our dehydrocholesterol and we increase the risk of skin cancer from using the sunscreens and the oils that you all think are so good for you. You cause skin cancer. In countries that don't use these oils, they have the lowest incidence of skin cancer. They're outdoors running virtually naked in Africa and different places, and these individuals don't get skin cancer at the incidence we do. We get it because we use a lot of oils in our diet. Use a fat-free salad dressing. Get a clue. Caldwell Esselstyn says, don't add oils to your food. I told this to Terry Grossman. He agreed with me. Now his blood looks immaculate. His health is sparkling. And you deplete nitric oxide every time you use oil in your diet. Every time. And nitric oxide helps sleep. It helps the neurotransmitters. It's that missing elusive factor besides the melatonin and the other factors of light and dark. You have to have enough nitric oxide. And most of you are deficient nitric oxide, A, because you don't know what foods to eat. And when you do the microscope test in the back, we give you a list of the foods that are rich in nitric oxide. And when you restore nitric oxide, we're going to do a simple test. Did my staff test your nitric oxide yet? Well, if not, raise your hand. We'll get you tested at the break. And I want to find out who has the best nitric oxide in this room. But what does nitric oxide support? What is it? It's a molecule. It vasodilates. It's one of the most important, the Nobel Prize, 1998. They discovered the importance of nitric oxide. It supports heart function. It lowers blood pressure. It lowers, improves circulation, protects skin from melanoma, cancer, lowers LDL cholesterol, improves memory, increases bone density, improves sexual function, supports REM sleep cycle. You are depleted 99%, maybe accurate, 95% of the people I test are depleted or low in nitric oxide. When they start taking our product Stay Young, which has plant nitrates, and they start eating the foods such as kale, beets, pomegranate, Swiss chard, and bring that up to the optimum chart levels, you get all those benefits. That's important.
And what I can add is that I often will test people's arterial stiffness. So as you get older, your arteries get stiffer. And once they get stiffer, then they begin to clog up. But you can measure way before they clog that they're getting stiff. And nitric oxide has been just fantastic for stopping that process and reducing it and reversing it. We do have prescription medicines that can help, but there's a lot of complexity. So all the statin drugs work to reduce artery clogging, not because it lowers cholesterol, but because it has an anti-inflammatory effect on the arteries, which is the beginning of this hardening process. But statin drugs have other complexities. Then you get muscle pain, you get fatigue, you get liver issues. So it's not an ideal medicine, but if you have to choose between a heart attack and a cholesterol medicine, we'd probably pick cholesterol. But we have other options. Nitric oxide works as well as statin drugs and probably better to reverse this clogging process. And if you measure your own levels, you can tell that you're making a difference. We can actually measure your stiffness. We have a variety of mechanisms to measure stiffness way before you start clogging, and we can prevent hardening of the arteries. So this is something that is like a huge area of medicine. This isn't going to become traditional medicine in 10 years, but you may as well start it now.
Hey, Ty, can we get the nitric oxide strips and show everyone how to do it as a group, and we'll test everyone right now. It's interesting that nitric oxide, when you look up on the internet and they talk about, oh, this nitric oxide, it's a scam. That's the first things that come up at the top of the list. And they say, well, arginine, which is, as we know, in older people, there's a point where arginine, which is an amino acid, has to go through about 8 pathways. It gets too diluted, and it won't generally bring your nitric oxide level up to optimum levels. So Dr. Nathan Bryant and others that I've interviewed, Lou Ignario, the Nobel Prize winner, they stated that plant nitrates, the very plants that are highest in a nitrate, which we used to think was a harmful ingredient, is actually so beneficial that when you chew it up or you take the juice and you switch around beet juice in your mouth, or you take these Stay Young tablets, your nitric oxide goes up dramatically within hours of doing these simple things. And the internet, people love to go to Dr. Google, and everything they look up, oh, the internet's right. Oh, the internet knows everything. Really? It's just whoever optimized their highest level, you know, search engines, and they have more money to optimize. It doesn't mean it's right. I have medical journals in my files that I inherited from Nathan Pritikin that aren't even on Google. You can't find them. And they're critical in determining longevity, outcomes of disease, you know, the risk factors of rural populations that are no longer eating the way they did 50 years ago. So you really have to understand Dr. Google will be very little help to you. You really need to go to a think tank like ours, where we have groups of doctors and we've studied these things. And wouldn't you agree, Dr. Grossman, that if you and I interview, say, 100 of the top physicians, there's probably about a 95% agreement in the information we're giving forth. And yet, if you go on television, you ask, you know, I won't say Oz or any of these guys, but, you know, the Google search engine and so forth, there's a 95% disagreement saying that we're wrong, when the top doctors in the world say we're right. But they have agendas. They have meat industry, food industry, they have pharmaceutical industry. So they don't want you to know the truth. And you're always going to be lied to because there's always a financial agenda, even the vaccine industry. And I won't even get into that one. But let's just talk, you know, frankly, that if you really want to be healthy and you want to achieve your outcome, these 6 steps, whole raw foods and herbs, fitness level, extraordinary fitness level, at least 60 minutes a day of body movement, hormones at optimum, not at levels of a 60 or 70 year old. Who wants to live and act like a 60, 70, 80 year old? We take our 80 and 90 year olds and we bring their hormone levels to that of a 24 year old. Why? Because that's when they're optimum, not super high levels that athletes are injecting themselves to perform, you know, somehow a little better than they did at physiologic levels. But we have 80 and 90 year olds who are telling us, oh my gosh, I have my life back. My mind's clear. I feel great. This is incredible. I'm having sex again. I mean, this is what we're hearing from the 80 and 90 year olds. Imagine when you reach 100. I want to be having sex on my 100th birthday.
We can have great results with people, and there's different layers and levels. You know, foundational in my mind is the hormonal level. That's like foundational. If you're 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years old, and your hormone levels are not like a youthful person, it's a big problem. Now, there are some exceptions to that. You know, you can maybe find a yogi in India who is 100 years old and he behaves like he's 25. But the average person, you've got to have that level of hormones, and it's hard to eat and do everything healthy enough to bring your hormones up. It just doesn't seem to happen for the average person. So hormone levels is like a foundation. Then you have to add the other things on. You have to see where are you imbalanced. You know, you have to do the other things too. You have to have the fitness. You have to be exercising. You have to have healthy eating. And there's all these other things we haven't talked about.
Power of the mind?
The mind. I mean, you have to have good, healthy thoughts. You know, my wife and I run classes on marriage. And if you don't have a healthy marriage, if you're angry and resentful and upset and you're arguing and you don't feel intimately connected with your partner, that's a big problem, because that affects your hormones. That affects your oxidative stress. That affects your immune system. It affects all kinds of things in your physiology. You've got to have that balance too. So all these things are a part. But I'd say foundational is the hormones for most people. That's like the basis. And once you have that, then you can begin to add on all these other balanced out things, and people can feel great if you're doing everything. But for certain people, certain things are the weak point. You know, you may have somebody who's 30 years old and their hormones are fine, but they have a bad marriage, or they're not exercising, or they're eating terrible, in which case they don't need any hormones. They need to do all the other things. As you get older, you get to be 50, 60, 70, you've got to have that foundation of hormones and be doing all the other things too.
Yeah, and I think Deepak Chopra, Dr. Chopra, once stated that the average person has 60,000 thoughts a day, but half of them are negative. And you can interrupt that negative process and just catch yourself in the middle of it if you really are attuned, because you are the moments between your thoughts. You are not your thoughts. You have the choice as to what you focus on. And that's deep, what I just said. If you understand what I said, you can actually alter the quality of your life just by catching yourself in the midst of that negative thought. Oh, she's always late. Oh, I'm going to have a bad experience. Oh, I'm fat. Oh, you know, I'm tired. Really? You tell yourself you're tired. Guess what? You're going to focus on all the things that cause you to feel tired. If you say, all right, I'm a little challenged. Things are coming fast my way. I'm going to just elevate my thoughts above and think about my highest moment. Like, take a moment right now in your chair, get yourself just kind of relaxed, and think about a time when you were very happy. Like, it was an extraordinary experience. Like, it was just incredible, and you were so happy. I mean, you just got the raise. You just got told you won a competition. You just learned that you're going to sire a child, or maybe that's not a good thing. I don't know. But you find out all these wonderful things, and you're just feeling that thought of happiness, joy, love, and love is now pouring through the top of your head, throughout your entire body. Every cell of your body now is embodying health and love and happiness. At this very moment, you're at a peak state, higher than you've ever been before. Now magnify that 10 times. Now magnify that happiness 100 times. In fact, you're so joyous, you're going to say, yes, I feel good. Everyone, yes, I feel good. Now, how do you feel? Like that quick, in moments, you change your biochemistry, you change your hormones, you change your thoughts, your focus, and you can do that every minute of your life. Imagine what your life will be like moving forward, how you make better choices moving forward, how you eat healthier foods, you make informed choices, because most people are looking how not to get hurt. So the brain wasn't trained to be happy. The brain was trained to watch for emergencies and dangers and deal with them. So you're constantly in a negative state. That's the human nature. But you can change that. You don't have to worry about a tiger eating you on the way out of this door, on the way home. I mean, you might get run over by a car, but you know, the point is you need to empower, because the other side of it is, you can think about every negative thought you've ever thought of, which is what most people do. And you know that study by Dr. Chopra, he said, not only do people have negative thoughts every day, at least half their negative thoughts, they repeat the same negative thoughts the next day and day after day.